Do you think that the mind is a classical computer? Do you think it's a quantum computer? Do you think it's a hybrid classical quantum computer? Or do you think it is none of the above? Something fundamentally different?
Yeah. Present deliberation is we are so young with our words.
Mm.
Like, I think that some of these questions that me and you ask and we ponder over, we just are so inarticulate and rudimentary with the tools that we have. It would be like a kid who is 4 years old and is asking, but where does chocolate come from? And where do babies come from? And what is money? And how does that work? And it's just stressing itself out. And you're like, as an adult, like, relax. Like, you cannot, those aren't even important questions, first of all.
Right.
Like, you think, why are we here? Existence and so on are the most important. Yeah. Maybe it's so trivial from like some other perspective. And we think like, all we think, some of the Bernardo Castrops and the idealists and so on, they think all that is consciousness.
Yeah.
I remember thinking, man, the physicalist side is so closed-minded and they're so uncreative. Yeah. So let me go to the spiritualist side. And I find that, man, the mystics like are not mystical enough. All their major answer tends to uncreatively come down to it's consciousness. I'm like, what if consciousness is firstly, well, what the heck is it? But what if there's 12 other elements? Like, it's not even a dualist.
Mm.
It's like a 12-a-list or 157-a-list. I like the number 157.
Why?
There's various reasons.
That's interesting.
Yeah, the various reasons.
Can we get into any of them or no?
Off-air.
Okay.
So
cool.
Anyhow, so from our level, I wonder if it's like we think existence and why are we here and what is consciousness and a hard problem of consciousness. We think that these are the deepest, most profound, most inexplicable problems most profound problems. But maybe it's so trivial, like as an adult to a kid, like chocolate, like you don't even need to concern yourself with that. Just relax, like live your life.
Mm.
Yeah, I often wonder that. So I have this phrase that I say internally, which is like, the mystics aren't mystical enough.
Mm-hmm.
The mystics just come down to the same exact answer of all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm almost all the time, I'm terribly disappointed when I investigate a toe. It's like go in with high hopes thinking like it's going to be the answer.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, is that what you're saying? Is that all that you're saying?
Yeah.
I thought that it was going to be much more vast and be mind-blowing.
Yeah.
It's like all the same sort of mind. If it's mind-blowing, it's mind-blowing in the exact same way.
Yeah. Well, first off, I fully agree with you in terms of larger kind of epistemology. And yes, it always gets, it's like the thinking itself is fascinating up until the conclusion. And then that sort of makes it more banal or something. I will say, I think a lot of the early quantum field theorists felt more mystical than a lot of the current scientists today. And I think about our epistemology, and there is something, I don't necessarily believe the Penrose kind of orchestrated objective reduction thing.
But that's creative, by the way.
It is.
I love him for that, for the fact that he's willing to go out on a limb and connect, firstly, consciousness to something quantum mechanical, then to something gravitical, like something gravity.
Absolutely. And he was super criticized. He was kind of cast out at that point from the physics community. And I do find it interesting, something in that realm of like the mind creates the classical kind of perception that we see. We use sort of relativity to explain like cosmology or something, but maybe there's more ontological truth. Maybe the quantum stuff isn't just shut up and calculate in a set of mathematical formalisms, but is a descriptor of reality. And then you get into all sorts of weird philosophical questions, because then it's like, okay, so time doesn't work the way we think it does and all sorts of issues like that. But to me, that's such an exciting inroad. And then you read about Niels Bohr, or you read about, you know, Heisenberg. You know, I'm reading the Ravelli's Helgoland, and I've read Beyond Physics, which is sort of a Heisenberg's own account of some of his work, but the more philosophical thinking behind it. And it's like, these guys were trippy philosophers, you know, they weren't like these, like, you know, I have the answer. Like they were like, sort of, it was this like constant inquiry process, and they were really touching at like, you know, what is reality? And even Einstein, who he got in all these debates with the Copenhagen School, he was like, God doesn't play dice, you know?
Yeah.
And they were thinking about like, what is the truth and what is reality? It wasn't just straight to like, you know, instrumentalizing the thing, or like, I have this like, you know, little kitschy theory or whatever. So
philosophy used to be integrated with physics. Like the philosophers that you, sorry, the physicists you mentioned were akin to philosophers.
They're talking about
what is, what does this mean?
Yes.
And now in Tim Maudlin was saying, he's a philosopher of physics.
Yeah.
He was on the show. He was saying, they don't teach you quantum theory in school. Like when you go to a class on quantum theory, for second year, third, even in your graduate school, graduate studies, it's not quantum theory, it's quantum mechanics,
right,
or quantum field theory.
Right.
It's a theory not only gives you the math, but tells you what is it describing. So Tim would say, every time he went to the lectures for any of the physics classes, the best lecture would be the first one. Because they would give you this, they would sell you on the course. And then after that, then they abandon that. They're like, okay, here's Green's functions. And here's a Hilbert, here's a self-adjoint operator. And then you wonder, okay, well, what is that representing? And what does that mean? And he said, you would ask, he'd put his hands up and the professor would say, well, for that, you'd have to go to the philosophy department. He said, I thought physics was about what is. You're not telling me what we're doing. So yes, that is something that's lost. And also physicists are making metaphysical assumptions without knowing. So there's a concept that I bring up frequently called enthymemes, meaning that there are statements with assumptions that are so hidden, we don't realize we're making them. Okay, classic example is the fish that doesn't understand us in water.
Yes.
And then
I think David Foster Wallace.
Yeah, and Wittgenstein had comments that of something called clarificatory remarks, which is those aspects of the world that are so simple and familiar that they remain hidden.
Oh, that's fascinating.
So Ed Witten had a theorem with Weinberg that said, essentially it says that in 3+1 quantum field theory, so 3 space 1 time, quantum 3+1D quantum field theory, there can be no graviton. Essentially says that. So it sounds like, well, what's the hope then? You can never integrate gravity with quantum field theory. And then the enthymeme, the hidden assumption that even was so subtle, Witten didn't make it explicit, didn't realize he was making it, is that you're assuming the graviton is within the same space-time. So what if there's another space-time associated with it? And that's where you get the idea of holography.
Yeah.
So that there's a quantum field theory happening on the boundary, but in a different space-time on the interior, there's gravity.
You know what you're making me think? Is that like maybe it's just super valuable to like work on your own fundamental epistemology. And that helps you create the theory. Like, I think about Eric Weinstein's like, you know, you have the observerse and then you have like 14 dimensions sort of above that, and gravity sort of is the tether between the two. And it's like, I can say that theoretically, I don't really know what that means. Is there a way to access those 14 dimensions? And maybe is there a way to change your state to like understand these things? That's, and that would be like an Eastern sort of mystical thing, but like, I don't know.
When it comes to questioning your epistemology or one's epistemology to get to something truer, I also wonder, like you said, maybe our bodies are so much more intelligent, and our bodies know, and we're trying to analyze like this, like the monkey atop the elephant, and we think we're in charge.
Yeah,
it's Ian McGilchrist talks about that in the Master and His Emissary. And I also take that analogy a bit further. I think one of the, and this is a present deliberation, so like it's something that I've only been thinking about for a couple of weeks. I think it's extreme. One of the worst philosophies of our time.
Yeah.
Is like that book, The Subtle Art of Not Giving an F, where you shouldn't care what other people think.
Yeah.
I think other people are way smarter than you.
Totally.
I put a huge, huge emphasis on other people, much like if you trust your body is smarter. And so I was thinking, someone was saying, I was speaking with someone in the internal toe team, and he was saying, the world shouldn't be like that. Something like that. Like, the world shouldn't be like that. Then I'm like, you think you have an ideal in your head? Like, you think your ideal is better than what is? Like, I almost always think that. But then if I think deeply enough, like, I'm like, wow, why do we even shake hands? Why do we bow? Why do we have to have niceties? Maybe a world without that would be way worse. Like, you think you're smarter than the entire calculation of the world?
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Like,
take into account what other people think. If other people are not liking what you're doing, modify. It doesn't mean supplicate.
Totally.
It doesn't mean be weak and indecisive.
Yeah.
It just means like listen to what other people are saying. Incorporate even the fact that we're not like this.
Yeah.
Hey, man, what's up?
Yeah.
Like, we just know because
we just know.
Like, you would
convention is there for a reason.
Or maybe it would be closer. But I realize it.
Yeah, yeah.
And it would just be so subtle, and our bodies do it because we care. And I think the people who say don't care about what other people think, maybe I think you should care more than anyone else. Like, if you're thinking that...
Yes.
I think your family would say, I think, John, you should be caring a little bit more about what we think.
Yeah. Well, that kind of sums up like my departure from like the Sam Harris crowd, where it felt like he was like really throwing the baby out with the bathwater and just saying all of these tenets of like Western civilization, which religion is kind of an endemic part of, we can reconstruct through rationality now. And to me, that leads to like effective altruism, utilitarian thought, which are predicated on this idea that like people are sort of interoperable cogs and this sort of, you can systems thought can sort of like design our, you use design principles and, you know, we'll figure it out. And like that feels wrong to me, you know, like I'm much more of a fan of like Lindy, you know, this idea that like things have survived in civilization, like formalities, convention, tradition, because it's every generation's job to kill off bad ideas. And so the Lindy ideas, the current age of something actually predicts its future expected age and the value of it. And I just think that's like a beautiful sort of principle.
Yeah, so in probability, we say like there's no such thing as a hot hand, or like if you flip a coin, if it's tails five times in a row doesn't mean it's going to be heads. But this is the opposite. This is saying like, look, if it's tails, the fact that it's historically been tails or historically been successful means it's more likely to be successful than something else that's new.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Again, present deliberation. I've also been thinking about effective altruism.
Yes.
And I remember hearing that the eight-year-old Kurt up until 28-year-old Kurt, let's say, would completely be like, yeah, effective altruism and utilitarianism and rational morality.
Right.
And now I just see so many problems. Like, how do you solve this? How do you solve that? How do you solve this? And effective, I don't believe when someone's like, I'm an effective altruist. I just don't believe you.
I don't either.
Believe that you, if you believe yourself to be a good person, I just don't believe you. I'm sorry.
Like, I agree that. I totally. You have to be, I think... And this is part of Christianity.
You start a piece of ish. You are a piece of
ish. Yeah.
And you are so motivated by trying to seem good, and you're egocentric, and I'm narcissistic, and I'm insecure, and I am selfish, and I'm just rotten. And it's obviously you can get self-flagellating about it. And I would look at movies where people like self-flagellating, and most people are like, oh, that's wrong. I'm like, that's like what we all should be doing. Like, have you taken yourself seriously enough?
Yeah, no, but acknowledging your own depravity is a very powerful thing. And I think about a lot of, not to bash baby boomers, but I think about like the baby boomer mentality, and a lot of it just felt like virtue signal. Like, utilitarianism is wildly effective in the political sense. It's super charismatic. Uh-huh. Like, you think about like Bill Gates. I go back and forth on like what his deal is.
Yeah.
But I think he's more sort of ruthless than meets the eye, would be my guess.
Like it's a guise to attain power.
Correct.
In a different sense, because you can, political power is much more of a weight than the dollar or per unit time or effort or.
Yes. Yeah. Totally. Yeah. It's like its own will to power, and it's the most charismatic.
It could be unconscious.
Will to power.
Too.
Yeah, and it could be totally unconscious, but yeah, like the Sam Bankman-Fried Freed FTX thing or whatever, where you know it's like you have to be the most moral person. Like you're the only way to be hyper capitalist is to be hyper idealistic, hyper philanthropist, and hyper. You have to be somehow Gandhi and you know John D. Rockefeller at the same time. Uh-huh. It's this bizarre thing. Yeah. And so like the only way to be that ruthless is to like hide it in this sort of, and I think about that sort of with respect to Marxism and stuff. Like Stalin is like, I think about this, like Stalin's, we think of Hitler is still the proverbial like worst person in the world. Stalin is definitely a bad person, but he's not thought of in as bad terms as Hitler. And I think that's because fascism is overt and Marxism is covert. Uh-huh. And so there's something about the utilitarianism thing where like you can really hide like the most dangerous ideas in the name of like sort of nominal equality. Yeah. So I think, like you said, being suspect of anybody that doesn't acknowledge their own depravity.
If you enjoyed this Toll clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toll Mail, which is, again, in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toll community. You'll also receive my top 10 Tolls. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.